Hey, thanks for having me, guys. I was just telling Mike upstairs how excited I am for y'all. You get to do all of this stuff, and you get to meet all these different people. You get to visit with some of these people that have been around the block several times. Okay, and you all have the opportunity to be a lot less lost than I was, okay, and a lot less frustrated than Todd ever got, and probably a lot less mad than Rusty ever got. Okay, so there was a lot of collateral damage along the way, where we were trying to help these kids, and we kind of banged them up also along the way. So I'm excited for y'all to be getting some tools before you kind of head out into the great outdoors with these guys and gals. So like Mike was saying, I'm here to visit with you guys about your calling in life, and then how do we have these kind of conversations with these kids and teenagers. We only have 45 minutes together. I don't think we're gonna solve everybody's life purpose right here in this next 45 minutes. I do think we can get a conversation started though that can be helpful for everyone. I work at a hockey rink now in Austin called the Pond Hockey Club, and we have youth hockey leagues, adult beer leagues. It's very similar to Explore Austin in that we have a bunch of kids running around. There's a lot of adventure, a lot of action. There are life skills being imparted on people. You know, whether the parents signed up for that or not, that's actually what we do. And then I also work here at Acton, and one of the courses I teach is called The Life of Meaning. Okay, it's a course Mike has taught before. The whole semester is about figuring out what you want to do with your life, okay, which is an ongoing process, obviously. I actually only have three questions for you, okay? And the first question is, what's the difference between a planned life and a purpose-driven life?
A purpose-driven life has a calling. A planned life is boring.
Somebody said steps you follow? Jared? Okay.
Like a checklist.
It's calculated. Feels expected.
Feels expected?
Yeah, expected of you for expectations.
Okay. Elaborate on that. What do you mean by that?
Are you internalizing other people's expectations about how to grow up?
Okay. So your drive versus what other people expect?
It can even become your drive based on what other people expect. All right.
A purpose-driven life allows for pivoting.
Mm-hmm. Adaptability.
Genuine.
Great word, pivoting. What do you mean by pivoting?
I really liked how someone described this season with me. It's like calling an audible. If something doesn't align well with kind of what your calling is, then transitioning into something different that is more fulfilling.
Good.
That's actually what I was gonna say, that the planned life doesn't allow for exploration.
Purpose-driven life is derived from self-reflection.
Okay. It's more conceptual.
Okay.
What do you mean by that?
In the sense of it's more philosophical. You have certain goals, and you want to, these things have to align with those goals. It's not a task-oriented where you start checking boxes. Does this align with what my goals are, what my mission statement is?
Okay. Conceptual, philosophical. Can I work messy?
It's also
more spiritual because it's internally motivated instead of external.
Riskier.
Riskier? What do you mean by that?
Because a plan life, you can kind of, it's been done before a lot of times. You kind of see what's going to happen and you're not really blazing it, that path. And so when you're purpose driven, you're like,
it's unique to you.
So a lot of this over here I'm hearing is conceptual, philosophical, messy, spiritual, riskier, probably hard to measure versus you can probably have some stepping stones along the way that you hit this mark, this mark, this mark, it's measurable. Somebody from over here.
I feel safer, which feels nice.
Okay, so the opposite of whisker is feel safer. What's that about?
Predict comfort. What's coming? The opposite would be
predictable. Predictable?
Predictable.
Predictable?
Planned life is future driven and purpose is present driven.
Okay. Future driven.
That was good. I think a purpose driven life only you can understand.
Okay. Why is that?
People don't always see the vision that you see. So I feel like with a plan life, it's easier to explain to everyone else, but if you're living a purpose-driven life, you can't always explain it. Okay. So everyone may want to understand it.
Because it's intrinsically motivated. Purpose-driven lives are intrinsically motivated.
Any other thoughts here? What are the big differences? Laura?
I think a purpose-driven life combines what you're good at and where there's a need.
I think decisions in a plan life are often fear-based.
Okay. Can you give an example?
Yeah, like if you're afraid that if you don't get married at a certain age, then you're going to end up alone. You're like, I don't know, you're trying to meet these expectations that don't necessarily have to do with your own personal desires.
Okay, so we jump through these exact hurdles. There's security in that. Okay, if we go to college, we can probably get a better job. Okay, if we get engaged and married by a certain age, we're more likely to have kids, so on and so forth. Okay.
Well, I would, with the purpose-driven life, there has to be some sort of, like, burr in your saddle or something that's really, that there's some drive, and maybe that's just the need that we've already highlighted, but there's something that's you're wanting to change, some injustice, some.
I think the purpose-driven life, you have to be more honest with yourself, and that's hard to do.
Why is that?
Because you have to really understand what you want.
Why is that so hard?
Because you have to be vulnerable.
There's so many influences.
Okay. That's good. Planned life, you might be doing it for other people, but purpose driven, you're doing it for yourself.
Okay. So it's this.
I actually think that's the opposite.
There's
planned life for you.
How many of you agree with what Aaron just said? A planned life is for other people. A purpose-driven life is for you. Why do you agree?
A planned life probably fits a mold that maybe society puts on you. Purpose-driven is your, is what's your purpose, is you're living for what you think your purpose is, that you can find for yourself.
Okay.
But sometimes it's planned life is about exerting control. You feel like you have control over what you're acting on. So it could be for yourself as well.
Okay.
It depends on
the
what you're open to.
Yeah.
All right. So it depends on the situation, depends on the person, depends on the plan, depends on what it's derived from.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
depends on how you define success. Is a successful life to you?
Also, like, people have different tolerances for change and difficulty. So for some people, if you're willing to change a lot, maybe your purpose is taking you there a lot, and that's okay. But for some people, they want to plan.
Sure. We all have different risk tolerance levels. Some of them we're born with, some of them we've developed over time. Okay? Any other thoughts here? The difference between a purpose-driven life and a planned life. Okay. So the second question, hopefully about 80 or 90 or 100 years from now, you're all gonna be laying on your deathbed, okay? Or maybe even longer than that. What's gonna matter the most to you when you're lying on your deathbed? Take a minute and think about it.
I would say not having regrets.
No regrets about what?
About the life you've lived, choices you've made, choices you haven't made.
Can you give an example?
A regret could be, I decided to move to this city and take this job as opposed to moving to that city and taking that job. Or I didn't get on that bus.
To make it even more personal, what would be a regret you would have 80 years from now in that type of situation?
In 80 years, a regret that I might have when I didn't show up for Explore Austin interview.
Okay. When you're laying on your deathbed 80 or 100 years from now, what's really going to matter to you? Regrets? No regrets? What else?
I would want to be surrounded by people that love me and I love.
I want to know I had a positive impact on people's lives.
Okay, so surrounded by loved ones, some sort of evidence that you've had a positive impact. For somebody else?
Did someone shed a tear?
Legacy?
Gently. Would be
so this is kind of
I think our culture is very consumption driven, but a lot of stuff I've read and listened to is when people are dying, they think about their connections with people and not what they've consumed.
Connections, relationships. So this is things that really don't probably don't have a whole lot to do with money or going to the mall. Yeah. What's gonna matter to you when you're laying on your deathbed?
Traveled, seen the world.
Mm-hmm. Why would that be important? Or why would that be a regret if you hadn't done that?
Perspective.
Mm-hmm. Perspective?
Yep.
Using your time, your limited time, effectively.
Well, it goes back to the connections and relationships, too.
Being a lifelong learner, connecting with others.
Yeah. Realizing there's different ways to do things.
Yeah, but I was open-minded.
ways, open-minded. Why is it important that you want to have been somebody that had a lot of perspective, you're a lifelong learner, you've been open to different ways, open-minded?
There's a sense of fulfillment with all of those, because you're connected to people.
Right, you're better equipped.
Fulfillment?
You're better equipped to connect with people if you have these things.
Okay, so this helps with this, and then this fulfillment, selfishly, I feel like a better person.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. A happier person.
Happier?
Yeah.
You have to experience life to get those things.
Yeah, it's all like...
experience, yeah.
Those equates like living life. So if you never visit out of, you know, Texas, people would say like, you gotta live life because you haven't been outside of the state, but you can live a full life by living in Texas your whole life too. So I think it's all about perspective and what your values are. So
you guys have all heard that quote, life is like a book, and if you don't travel, you only get to read one page. Mm-hmm. Okay, it's kind of true. Yeah. A lot of good stuff up here. Is there anything else that you're like, this is going to really matter to me? Aaron.
Just having fun.
Why is that so important?
Happiness.
Happiness? Why is that important, Aaron?
It's chemical. It's ingrained in us, I guess.
It can make us more resilient, give us a voice.
And if you're having fun, then you're like truly present in your time, the time you're spending on something.
Oh. We're doing the things that are really fun. Are we even capable of being somewhere else? Mm-hmm. Some of you probably, I'm not. Yeah. Okay. Tell me about this resiliency.
Yeah, I think when you're enriched with this fun, you, you're able to see challenges, shrink them down to a reasonable size.
So this helps with our attitudes towards challenges.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. And then that feeds a lot, bunch of this other stuff. Okay.
Take that one.
Sure.
Who did I love and who loved me? Mm-hmm.
That's so much more than I would say how much I loved.
Who did I love and who loved me?
Did they know that I loved them?
And how did I show it? Okay. So if we look at this board, everything you described, the stuff you're really going to be thinking about when you're on your deathbed can be grouped into three basic questions. Who did I love and who loved me? Did I make a meaningful contribution? And then the third one is, was I a good person? Okay. Okay. And a lot of this stuff, there's some bleed over. They're not three separate buckets. Okay. You do one or two of these things really well. Sometimes the third one becomes a natural consequence of the other two. Okay. Okay, so we're still sort of at this, we're asking you to think 80 years down the road, kind of a 30,000 foot level, very philosophical. Okay, what the hell are we gonna do about it, all right? Third question I have for you today.
I
what was it that made you want to sign up to be a mentor at Explore Austin?
I wanted to get outside of myself.
Why did you want to do that?
Because it's easy to stick within your comfort zone, your bubble. And I knew there was a lot more.
Okay. There's growth. Okay, we get out of our comfort zone.
Wanted to give back.
Wanted to give back, yeah.
Had some really awesome mentors over the years. It felt like it was time and I could provide that.
Somebody along the way made a difference to you. And whether you realized it at the time or you realized it a decade later, okay? Why were you drawn to Explore Austin?
Fun.
Fun. What sounds fun about Explore Austin?
Getting outside and doing stuff, new activities.
Okay. What are some outdoor activities you love to do?
Kayaking.
Yeah. Okay, kayaking.
Hiking.
Hiking.
So the group aspect is really fun. Social.
Group / social. Yeah. Okay. You can make some friends or deepen relationships you already have. What else drew you to Explore Austin?
Being a part of a community that has similar values. Mm-hmm. Not similar people, but similar values.
Why is that important to you?
Because I want to live out my values, and I think
new challenges.
Okay. What are some new challenges you think you're gonna have? That you're excited about?
Yeah, well, I think you get to a point in your life, at least for me, where you've had like a lot of leadership experience. So you start to think like, oh, I know how to do this, do that, but I think you're never done learning. So I think being in this environment and not being the actual trip leader, just being our support and working with the group of people you have no clue about, and I'm a new state, I'm not from Texas, so I'm not too familiar with it. So it's, even though I have all this experience, it's a new challenge for me, and not thinking, hey, I know all the answers, or I am gonna make an impact, but just being open to be challenged to be there for someone else besides myself.
Some of the scary challenges are the most fun, especially in hindsight.
Yeah.
All right. Why else were you drawn to Explore Austin?
Connecting with kids and showing them what else is out there.
Teaching and showing.
Experiencing like an upbringing other than your own.
Some of this perspective you were talking about, okay, all from different zip codes.
There are a lot of like institutions in our culture that tell kids what to do, but Explore Austin is more about them guiding themselves through something. Like school tells kids what they should do, but there aren't a lot of exploratory opportunities.
So fostering independence. Why is that attractive?
Because you see the success.
Why is that gratifying?
Because you want people to have fulfilling lives.
Sense of self-worth.
It validates. Validation. Oops.
I know.
Wait, so Jared and somebody over here, what does it validate?
That we're making a difference.
Yeah, impact.
Okay.
You're giving them something in that whatever 6 years that they're going to take to the rest of their lives.
Okay.
I wouldn't have said this when I signed up a year and a half ago, but after this morning session, I am excited about learning from my kids going forward. Okay, so like, there's almost a selfish reason there now is to learn from them.
So learning from the situations you're going to be in, learning from the kids themselves, learning from your fellow mentors, okay, learning from the mistakes you're going to make along the way, the successes you're going to have along the way. So getting outside yourself, new challenges, giving back, the fun activities, okay, connecting with kids. You can get a lot of these things and other activities and endeavors. Why explore Austin?
Well, one of the reasons I like Explore Austin is because you can help show kids that they can do things they never thought they would be able to do.
Okay. How is that different at Explore Austin than doing it as a teacher in elementary school?
The element of like the environment and nature, connecting with ourselves and the kids with our bigger world, like you can't do that in a school.
It's kind of Why not?
Because you're inside and there are institutional values and rules.
Okay.
There's also a set curriculum in how you teach.
Mm-hmm. Say it again.
There's a set curriculum that had to teach as a teacher.
Oh.
The roles are different as a mentor and a mentee, like what Lewis was saying, like we're facilitators, we're not teachers, we're not standing in front of the class saying like this is how you do something. So saying like, I don't know either, let's figure it out together.
Okay. So these, you'll have different roles at different times. Okay. You'll be a coach. You'll be a mentor. You'll be a friend. You'll be a student. Okay. You'll be a parent. Okay. All over the map here. All right. And then maybe the variety of that is appealing or scary. Yeah. Yes,
one of the things that drew me to Austin was you're in it for the long haul. But it's not in once a month, like when I feel like it, you're really making a commitment to being a part of it. And that's a sacrifice.
Okay.
That was attractive to me.
So one thing that is unique is the 6 years. Okay, that scares a lot of people off. That excites a lot of people also. That's normal.
I think also there's a lot of potential in the organization itself to grow. So you know, we're putting in 6 years, we can see 6 years of growth as a whole.
Okay.
And like in the city. So you know, it's been around 10 years, so I guess a lot of people don't know about it yet, but even when it's like 16 years,
yeah,
we're a part of that growth.
So, yeah. So we have our own little group of, it's us and our 15. There are other classes. There are other grades, okay?
It's not a job. I mean, that's, but what about the roles? Like, no matter how much fun you're having or how purpose-driven, if you have a job, that's your job. And this is not that. This is volunteering for values.
So you guys signed up. You signed away a decent chunk of your life, basically. You're not getting paid. Okay, there are very few extrinsic rewards. You will get some swag probably here and there, maybe a lost paddle to take it home with you. Okay, and a lot of this stuff, it doesn't come without a price. Okay, there's some suffering involved, some discomfort, some inconvenience. Okay, you will have a Saturday event the same day as a UT home game that you've got tickets for. And you're not getting paid. So why are you doing this?
Experience.
Elaborate on that.
I think a lot of this comes down to the experience that you're dedicating your time to and growing within yourself and you're providing to other people so you can have a fulfilled life.
Yeah.
Okay.
Just keep supporting.
I think it keeps coming back to the connections and relationships. It's everything that we've
It's constantly challenging.
Yeah. Challenging. Okay. We stop being challenged, we start dying.
I think for me, one of the reasons I got into it, and I've been in it 3 years now, is just learning about yourself and getting out of your comfort zone. You don't learn diddly if you're not out of your comfort zone. And, I mean, I'm 37 years old, and we've got our kids, they were 11 years old, so I'm trying to remember, holy crap, like, what did I do when I was 11? I can barely tie my shoes. And so I'm supposed to relate to this kid, try to tell him something that's, you know, maybe he's going to remember when he's 37. So it was totally like an awkward experience. But now we have this tight-knit group and this bond that's pretty unbreakable.
Yeah.
We built that, both us and the explorers.
Yeah. And then later on down the line, it's actually not about the shoes. Okay, mm-hmm. It's about something much deeper than that. Okay, you guys that are starting to point to this board, I think we're starting to come from 30,000 feet down to like 10 feet. This, how the heck do we figure out what we're gonna do with our lives, okay? And just like we did over here, everything you described sort of fits with these three questions in the same way. I didn't ask you what called you to explore Alston, okay? But many people would describe it as a calling, okay? There was something about it, and maybe you couldn't even put your finger on it at the time, but you were called, okay? So here's how we figure it out, or here's the beginning of how we figure it out, okay? Okay, this one didn't necessarily come up. When I asked you, what drew you to explore Alston? I could have asked, is there a skill set that you bring to the table that is easily applied in this context? Yes? What are you good at that we can use at Explore Alston?
Having fun to people around me, bringing out silliness and fun to people around me.
Helping others in social situations, okay? What else are y'all good at? Jared.
Just leading the way, or I'm always willing to just try something, even though I may be scared, I'm gonna try it. And just lead in that way, mostly. I have the other risk assessors on my team.
A lot of the stuff that y'all are going to do outside, and I know you already have a year under your belt, is not going to scare Jared, okay? He can probably do it 10 times, okay, without even like breaking a sweat. He's good at some of this stuff. What else are y'all good at? Be specific.
Being organized.
Being organized.
Someone's got to do it. I'm really good at it.
Okay. Every mentor group needs one of these. All right. What else are y'all good at?
A lot of the times in my family or my friend groups, I'm always the reliable one, the one that people can go to vent their issues with.
Okay. Level-headed foundation. What other skills do you bring to the table?
Actual technical calm. Skills.
Technical skills, like what?
Not biking, rock climbing.
Yeah. I'm assuming some of you have some experiences like mountain biking, rock climbing. Okay. Some of you could probably teach courses on these subjects. All right. Anything else?
Grit.
Grit.
Nice.
Okay, grit and experience.
Yeah, grit.
All right. All right. So, this is the stuff you're good at. And you can figure out what these are by writing down a list of the things you're already good at. And then ask, these are the things your friends, family, peers, they compliment you on these things.
whether you're aware of it or not. You can ask them. But these are the things they're always telling you, and you're good at that. Like, or thank you for doing that. You did a much better job than I could have. Okay, that's a skill you've mastered. All right. The second thing we have to do . All right, this came up in the previous question. Look at the world's needs. Okay, when I say the world's needs, I don't mean like on a global level, solving things all over the world. I mean your world, the markets that you come across, the missions you're familiar with, the unsatisfied customers you come into contact at your business. Stuff in the world, like where wrongs need to be righted, okay? Excuse my grammar. All right, and then the third one is obviously identifying your passions. First word to say fun, or who was the first person to say the word fun? It took way too long. All right. Like, how many of you do stuff in your like off time, like when nobody's paying attention, because it's fun? Like way too much of it. Yeah? Okay, this is what we should be doing with our time. Okay. This is the stuff that gets you fired up to get out of bed, okay? This is also the stuff that's scary, challenging, where growth happens, okay? Where risks are taken, all right? What does passion come from?
Desire? Yeah, excitement, like what gets you fired up every day? What makes you want to go to your job and keep serving?
Give us an example, like personal to you. What does it come from for you?
I think fulfillment, like knowing you're making a difference. Validation.
Injustice,
yeah. Fighting the right battle, okay? What else does, how is passion fostered or developed?
I'll say it comes from like fear sometimes. Fear of failure or not being good enough through your passion.
It comes from some of our insecurities, okay, and some of these deep-rooted things we have from our childhood and or a mishap along the way, yeah?
Vested interest. Oh, sorry.
I say sometimes passion, like what gets me passionate is sharing some with other people that I think is just like so awesome. Like I have to just share with everybody. That's what makes me passionate about it.
Yeah. Like, this sharing of this stuff we're excited about, okay? All right. So we start digging. Go ahead, I'm sorry.
No, we basically said the same thing. You have a vested interest, that shared care of something's success.
Okay. Yeah. So the fourth step is we combine all three, okay? So we have our skills, like the stuff we're good at. We have world's needs. And we have our passions. Okay? And we have a long list of things right here, and a long list of things right here, and a long list of things right here. We'll start to see clues of places where they all can be brought to life in the same endeavor. Okay, this crossover section right here, okay? This is where we should be busy spending our days, okay? These pursuits that bring this, this, and this all into play at the same time, okay? Very rewarding. great returns on your efforts, a lot of bang for the buck there, okay? Get busy doing this stuff. Okay? You'll have a lot of good results, but you'll also have some bad ones, okay? Be comfortable with the messiness of it, okay? It's not gonna go right all the time. But when you get busy doing this stuff, you don't have time for all the other stuff that doesn't fit in here, and that's all right. How are you gonna help your explorers with all of this philosophy mumbo jumbo?
Show them.
Show them? What do you mean by that?
Like leading by example.
Why is leading by example so much more powerful than telling people what to do?
Is it the decision to follow?
They're invested in the decision, okay? Much more powerful. How else are you gonna have these conversations with your kids?
Ask good questions, be a good listener.
It's amazing what will happen, especially with these teenagers. If you ask a question and then just let them be silent for like 30 seconds, they will get uncomfortable and just start like barfing stuff out. It's like, and it will be powerful. And it will also be hilarious, okay, and fun.
I think making these questions conscious, so that, like, I don't remember having these types of conversations when I was a kid.
Yeah, maybe like practice noticing this stuff.
I wonder how different my life would have been if someone asked me these three questions.
So whether you had these types of conversations in your house or at Little League or in your band or whatever you did growing up, okay, they're going to be memorable if they're done a lot, okay? Like, just like keep in mind, they are still, most of them are like about to be teenagers, or they are teenagers, and their brains are half cooked, okay? Literally, like, they're really, they're changing a lot, and they're pretty dumb, okay?
But I said no, they're not.
I mean that in a innocent, playful way. My teenager is really dumb. Yeah. Okay. Like, just make it a habit. Every time you get on the bus, somebody make it a point to, like, hey, let's just talk about one little piece of this. Okay? And if they're not open for talking about it, that's all right. Okay? How else are you going to have these conversations with your kids?
Around the campfire?
Why is that a good time?
I guess they're more vulnerable. They feel safe at that moment. They're tired.
Y'all had a session about powerful debriefs, right?
Yes.
Okay, and there's a right time and a place, okay, for different reasons. Okay, maybe it's just they're worn out enough that they're gonna sit still and they're ready to listen. Or they're worn out enough that their guard is down. Anything else we can do to make this really powerful for the kids? Yes, ma'am.
I think an important thing is to remind them what they're good at. So if we see a skill that they have, to tell them, like, hey, you're really good at that.
How many of us got encouragement from somebody else and realized we were good at something because somebody else took the time to notice and actually encourage us and say something about it? Very powerful, okay?
I think just in injecting some of this vocabulary, like in a digestible way, is powerful in and of itself, just because it calls in, it names things that maybe they're feeling or thinking but don't really have a word for it. If someone had talked to me at that age about a purpose-driven life, I would have had no idea what they meant, but I would have wanted to know more, and I would have loved for someone to talk to me about what that meant.
Well, and you're right, because vocabulary then empowers future conversations to happen that probably couldn't have before.
Yeah. It's a lot to process. You're using words they probably don't use, but helping that along, okay? Really good. Okay, so we ran out of time. We're gonna play a game, but the good news is you get to get up here in a minute. I do have a homework assignment for you, though.
You've got a few minutes if you want, because lunch doesn't officially start.
So okay. Well, it's lunch. You do have a homework. When is the next time y'all are all meeting for like a training or with your kids or?
It's all different Saturdays. So
okay. True.
Somebody's meeting with kids.
So in the next like few weeks or the next like couple months, you have another gathering as Explore Awesome Mentor. Maybe not as this group, but with your team. Okay, here's your homework assignment. Before your next meeting with your Explore Mentor group, whether it's a training session or your meeting to visit with your kids, I want you to write your own epitaph. Hey, what do you want your tombstone to say about your life? It's very organized. Getting it written down. That's good. Okay. Second thing, write your own eulogy. What would you want your closest friends or your most dearly loved ones to say about the life you live? Third thing, I want you to sit down with your fellow mentors and share. And have them share theirs with you.
You know, I just had like crazy deja vu about heart attack emergency that before. I've been writing my dreams down recently.
Oh.
It was really weird.
You're welcome.
You've been in my dreams.
Okay, Jared. Hey, thanks a lot for having me.
Thank you.